The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel!" As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord! Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven!"
They relieved the palms of their branches as the people's palms grasped and then brandished those leafy emblems of both festival and rebellion. These were a people who felt as though they had already spent their second, third, and last chances on zealots, men like Barabbas and that now famous Maccabean. But this Jesus, this new champion, was riding into Jerusalem on a donkey as Zechariah had envisioned him. This king was coming to daughter Zion to take the wicked Roman chariots away from Ephraim. Surely this Jesus was the one to bring God's people salvation. Surely he was the one pictured all across the prophet's hopeful panorama. So they shouted, "Save us, please." They cried, "Hosanna, Hosanna." And this Jesus would answer yes to their cry of "Save us, save us," but not in the way they expected. Not by the violent overthrow predicted by their palmy political propaganda. For the humility of that donkey was nothing compared to the way he would answer their shouts of Hosanna. For the path on which he rode took him not to a throne, but to a court. Not to a place fit for a heavenly king, but to the feet of an earthly lord. It was there, before another crowd, in the hands of Pilate, whom God endowed with the power to answer the shouts rising loud, demanding crucifixion for this man who was so recently avowed as Hosanna by those who had laid down a pathway of both palm branch and personal shroud. It was there that he would show how he would answer both crowds. Both the Hosanna save us cry and the incessant crucify. For what was missed by each tribe, by those who cried out their Hosanna boast and those who cried that this man should be nailed upon two posts, is that Jesus would say no to neither request. Instead, he would say yes to both.
A reading from John chapter 12. Verses 23 through 28. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life will lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name.
Now my soul is troubled. This is what Jesus said just days before he would be sentenced to death. A few days earlier, he had been inundated with praises from the crowds, and their joyful cries filled the streets of Jerusalem. But now, his soul was troubled. A few days more, and the scripture tells us that Jesus was anguished as he prayed in the garden. As difficult as Holy Week is, I am so grateful that we get to see a very human Jesus with his very human emotions, from joy to feeling troubled to experiencing anguish. Many of the emotions that we all go through as well. Rather than avoid them, Jesus allows himself to sit in them because he knew that God was doing something through them. This is the point of welcoming prayer, or the posture that Jason mentioned to us on Sunday, palms out, open, and up. This kind of posture, or this prayerful spirit, allows us to welcome anything that comes our way, the good, the bad, the joyful, the anguish. We are open to whatever comes into our lives, trusting that God is able to work through anything that comes our way. This also helps us to relinquish control, just like Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Not my will, but yours be done." Let's take a moment, just a few seconds, to sit with our eyes closed, our palms out, open, and up, and say the same thing to God. Not my will be done on this day or in this life, but yours, O God.
Jesus came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and knelt down and prayed. Father, Jesus said, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. He prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground.